I would like to thank all three speakers for really very well researched and detailed and focused presentations. Those three topics are very important for the proper ICU management of pediatric cardiac patients. The talks were very detailed. I will only make three comments to highlight, I think, some very key features of these topics, which the speakers themselves have actually pointed out. Regarding the mixed lesions, mixed shunt lesion management, I think an important take-home message would be to be very careful when managing these patients, not to allow the oxygen saturation, the arterial oxygen sat, to rise too high, as this may indicate pulmonary vascular bed steel of systemic output and therefore systemic hypoperfusion. That might be very, very important and could lead to the dreaded phenomenon of quote, end quote, unexplained sudden arrest in ICU. But I think this was very well explained by our speaker, as well as measures to handle it. Regarding the pediatric series problem, this was also very, very well covered by Dr. Apostolidis. One thing that I might stress, as he has, is that there are multiple measures taken by various teams to control this problem. There aren't really that good data to prove these points, but it is important to have a complete strategy to prevent and manage this very serious problem if it occurs. And I think two highlights of this management scheme would be to not forget heparin. Adequate heparinization is key, because if it is not, then this stimulates the whole process. And also, a very important component is adequate tissue perfusion. Tissue malperfusion and tissue ischemia, which can be very subtle, can actually trigger this syndrome. It is possible to have very normal or very acceptable or very satisfactory mixed venous oxygen saturation, and yet to have tissue perfusion in isolated vascular beds. That, I think, can be prevented by a strategy of aggressive systemic vasodilation, both during and also after bypass. And lastly, a comment on the postoperative bleeding. I think that this talk was also excellent, covered all the various possibilities, and I would fully agree with the management strategy that needs to be implemented in each unit and followed, of course, tailored to the patient. One comment I would have to say about postoperative bleeding is that if it is excessive, then we, the surgeons, must be the first to suspect that it might be a surgical problem, and we should intervene early rather than late. It is not very productive to hope that it's a coagulation problem. It is much better to prove that it is a coagulation problem by reoperating. In our experience, I cannot remember when we regretted having re-explored a patient bleeding significantly. And so again, I'd like to thank the speakers and turn over the podium to Dr. Rombola, who I'm sure has very important comments to make on these topics.
Hello, I would like once again To congratulate the organizing committee, especially Ms. Jiffa and Mr. Mitropoulos, for this excellent symposium. Congratulations to all speakers for their high quality presentations. About SIRS, after bypass, in adult patients, because I'm an adult ICU doctor, it seems that patient factors such as immune system activation plays a role before surgery. And I'd like to ask Christos if there is such information for pediatric population too.
Thank you for this question. As I've stressed out, there are various non-cardiac pulmonary bypass factors that may predict SIRS, namely age or low weight or temperature mm-hmm. or several other parameters. The problem is that we cannot specify which ones will lead to increased SIRS. And as I said, neonates lack the ability to tackle inflammation.
Okay, thank you very much.
Dr. Kavouras, any additional comments?
Congratulations for the presentation to all talkers. Speakers, what I would like to mention is regarding the first talk about the shunting is that every ACHD patient is unique. Even if they have the same disease, their shunting is totally different. So there should be tailor-made medications. And as you mentioned also, Dr. Saris, oxygen can be deleterious and can have a totally opposite, a completely different effect from what we expect. Should be very careful with administration of oxygen, and especially we should be very careful with the administrations of inotropes, since inotropes can cause harm instead of giving the what we need, the result that we want. And regarding the last presentation about bleeding, as you know, as the surgeons, and we all know that despite the fact that we have guidelines, we have consensus, definition of bleeding is still variable. Every center has a different threshold to when to transfuse, when to reoperate, when to re-explore. And we should be very careful about that. And it would be very interesting to identify the patients who are vulnerable to bleeding before the surgery. Thank you very much.
I'm also looking for questions. I can't say any. And I would like to ask if I have the opportunity about the position of antifibrinolytics in bleeding. What is the position right now in pediatric patients, either as a preventive measure, or even at the treatment, especially when the thromboelastometry or thromboelastography is not available to assess?
Well, I'm not sure that there is a uniform stance on this. There are different approaches. We certainly use antifibrinolytics, but I don't think there is a unified approach across the pediatric cardiac surgical community. Perhaps Christos can tell us his view on this.
Okay. Well, I agree with your point. There is no unified approach to this issue. We all use, but we have little evidence on what exactly is needed for these patients.
Okay, very good. Once again, if there are no other comments, I'd like to thank you. The speakers, the commentators, and everyone watching this very nice session. Now we will move to the next session after a brief intermission. Thank you very much.